فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
فلما استقر بالمدينة أمر ببقية شرائع الإسلام مثل الزكاة والصوم والحج والأذان والجهاد والأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر، أخذ على هذا 10 سنين، وتوفي صلى الله عليه وسلم ودينه باق، وهذا دينه، لا خير إلا دل الأمة عليه، ولا شر إلا حذرها منه، والخير الذي دلها عليه التوحيد وجميع ما يحبه الله ويرضاه، وشرك الذي حذرها منه شرك، وجميع ما يكرهه الله ويكفاه.
The author now, رحمه الله, he mentions that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم استقر في المدينة, that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he resided in Medina and he stayed in Medina after his hijrah to Medina. He stayed there عليه الصلاة والسلام. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, all of the other remaining legislations were sent on him. أمر فيها ببقية شرائع الإسلام. All of the other remaining legislations of the Sharia, he was commanded of it. وكانت مدة بقائه was what? How long did he stay there for? 23 سنة, 23 years. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he died in Medina. And, sorry, 13 years, sorry. Sorry, 10, sorry, sorry. 23 years in total. It's 23 years in total. It's 10 years in which he stayed عليه الصلاة والسلام in Medina. And 13 years in Mecca. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he died in Medina. His religion عليه الصلاة والسلام, it remained apparent. This religion of his was apparent. Our messenger بلغ الرسالة وأداها. Our messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he conveyed the message that was upon him. وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة. And he also fulfilled the duty of passing on that which he was entrusted with. He also عليه الصلاة والسلام, he sincerely advised the people and he did his job. We believe there is no khair إلا دلها عليه. There is no khair except he told us about it. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari said, لقد توفي رسول الله وما طائر يقلب جناحيها إلا ذكر لا منه علما. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari said a statement which is موقوف, it stops at Abu Dharr, is that he said that the Prophet ﷺ died and there was no bird that flapped its wings except that he told us something about it. A man came to Salman al-Farisi when he said to him, علمكم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كل شيء. Did the messenger teach you guys about everything? Salman al-Farisi, you said, yes. He even taught us how to do call of nature. He told us, ألا نستقبل القبلة ولا نستدبرها. He told us not to face the Qibla and not to face away from it. He also taught us that we do not use less than 3 أحجار, less than 3 rocks. He taught us everything we needed to know. Is it then correct? Does it logically make sense? A religion that told you when you go to the toilet how many rocks and what you need to use, would it leave off how you can govern a whole country? Would it leave that off? It wouldn't. It's a religion that came with everything that we need. It's a religion that answers every point in our life. And the greatest thing that Islam has told us about, and the greatest thing which He has called us to, is at-tawheed, worshipping Allah alone. If Islam didn't come and tell us about this, we would be like those who worship cows. Those who worship cows. In India, I was watching a video. A man's driving, a cow comes into the road, he worships the cow, he stops, he parks his car, he stayed the whole night because the cow wouldn't move. Yeah. Where's the aqal? Where's the intellect and the rationality that they were telling us about the humans have? Ya ikhwa, do you know what gave us aqal? Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's religion. Tawheed is what gave us aqal and understanding. Or else, we're no better than those people. No way, form or shape are we. We would have done the same. We would have eaten our God whenever we got hungry. Kufar of Quraysh, they made their gods out of idols. Whenever they got hungry, they ate it. That's how it was. They would marry their own mothers. When the father dies, and he's got wives, they will inherit the money and they would inherit their father's wives. It was part of the things that were inherited. It's Islam that came and fought against all of that, liberated women. Islam is the one. Where were these? Where was the Western civilization at this particular time? They didn't exist. And the greatest thing which the religion warned us against is shirk. Tawheed is the summary of all good. And shirk is the summary of all evil. And that's why the author specifically mentioned those two. Naam.
بعثه الله إلى الناس كافة وافترض طاعته على جميع الثقلين الجن والإنس والدليل قوله تعالى قل يا أيها الناس إني رسول الله إليكم جميعا وأكمل الله به الدين والدليل قوله تعالى اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا والدليل على موته صلى الله عليه وسلم قوله تعالى إنك ميت وإنهم ميتون ثم إنكم يوم القيامة عند ربكم تختصمون والناس إذا ماتوا يبعثون والدليل قوله تعالى منها خلقناكم وفيها نعيدكم ومنها نخرجكم تارة أخرى وقوله تعالى والله أنبتكم من الأرض نباتا ثم يعيدكم فيها ويخرجكم إخراجا وبعد البعث محاسبون ومجزيون بأعمالهم والدليل قوله تعالى يجزي الذين أساءوا بما عملوا ويجزي الذين أحسنوا بالحسنى ومن كذب بالبعث كفر والدليل قوله تعالى زعم الذين كفروا أن لن يبعثوا قل بلى وربي لتبعثن ثم لتنبؤن بما عملتم وذلك على الله يسير.
The author رحمه الله, he mentions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ila al-nasi kaffa. Nabiullah Muhammad was not sent to Arabs. He was not specific to the Arabs. He was sent to everybody. Kaffa here entails and it means al-jinn wal-ins. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent to the ins and he was sent to the jinn. Because the word al-nas, what did we say? What did we say the word al-nas? Yashmalu ha'ulai wa ha'ulai. It encompasses these people, meaning the jinn, and it encompasses the ins, fi asahhi qawli ahli al-lugha. According to the two views of the scholars, the strongest is that the word an-nas encompasses the jinn and the ins. Because the word an-nas originally roots from the word an-nawsi. The word an-nas originally, ma'khudun min an-nawsi. It's taken from the word nawsi. And the word nawsi means al-harakat wal-iddirab. It's when something moves. And that's something that is for the humans as much as it's for the jinns. The jinns, they move as well. So that's a meaning that is given to both. Then the author, he clarified and he said, وَافْتَرَضَ طَاعَتَهُ عَلَى جَمِيعِ الثَّقَلَيْنِ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنْسِ. Allah had made obligatory his obedience upon all of them, the jinn and the ins, obligatory for them. And this statement of his is a tafsir lil-ijmal al-waqi'. Because he just ambiguously said, بَعَثَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَى النَّاسِ. Allah sent him to the people. You might think this is only the humans. So he came and he expanded it for you, Shaykh Muhammad Abdul Wahab, telling you it means الثَّقَلَيْنِ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنسِ. Then the author, rahimahullah, he says, وَأَكْمَلَ اللَّهُ. Allah completed لِلنَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم, for the Prophet, الدين, the religion. The religion was completed for him, عليه الصلاة والسلام. It was made complete. For the messenger, based on the statement of Allah, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. اليوم أكملت, I completed your religion unto you today. It's complete. ثم مات صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then the Prophet died. Once the religion is complete, that was his job. That was what he was there for. It was to convey a message on behalf of Allah. Once that finished, he صلى الله عليه وسلم, he died. And this, that he died, tasdiqan li khabarillahi, is in accordance to the statement of Allah, innaka mayyitun, Muhammad, you are one dead, wa innahum mayyitun, and they are going to die as well. Allah said that. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those who say that he's alive, that is going against an ayah which is sarihun wadihun la ghubara fi. An ayah which is clear and there is no taint or dust on it. It's an ayah which is muhkam. Innaka mayyitun, you are dead, just like they are dead. So if you do ta'wil of the Prophet's death, then do ta'wil of everyone else's death then. Because the ayah is talking about each party, the Prophet is going to die and they are going to die. So if you say the Prophet is alive, then the people have to be also alive, because the ayah mentions both of them. Then the author then says, وَالنَّاسُ إِذَا مَاتُوا, if the people die, لَكِنْ يُبْعَثُونَ. So we don't believe that when you die, there it is, it's over. Nothing's going to happen after that. After death, there's something called al-ba'athu. What does ba'ath mean in the Sharia? What does the word ba'ath mean in the Sharia? It means قِيَامُ الْخَلْقِ, that the creation are going to stand. إِذَا أُعِدَّتِ الْأَرْوَاحُ إِلَى الْأَبْدَانِ, after the soul is brought back to the body, the people are going to stand بعد النفقة الصورة الثانية, that the people are going to stand after the body receives the soul and the trumpet is blown. وبعد البعث, and after the resurrection, Allah تبارك وتعالى, He will what? يحاسب الناس. He's going to account the people. And they are going to be rewarded in accordance to their actions. What does the hisab mean in the Sharia? It means عَدُّ الْأَعْمَالِ, your actions are going to be counted the day of judgment. That is what hisab means. People always confuse the difference between hisab and jaza. They don't mean the same. Hisab does not mean jaza. Hisab means accounting. And jaza means الثواب عليها بالمقيم بالنعيم المقيم. It's to reward the person after you've accounted their rewards and you've looked at everything. The jaza means that you're now going to give them a reward in accordance to the action. Or al-adhab al-aleem. Or you're going to reward them with a severe punishment. May Allah protect us from it. The author then says, وَمَنْ كَذَّبَ بِالْبَعْثِ, anyone who disbelieves in the resurrection and says, I don't believe that we're going to be resurrected. كَفَارَ, he disbelieves. He's not a believer. Because Allah said in the Quran, and the author brought this as an evidence, زَعَمَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, the disbelievers claimed. So Allah referred to them as what? Disbelievers. And Allah also claimed to it as what? Za'am. Za'am is what? Za'am is da'awa. It's claim. It's a mere claim. So anybody who says we're not going to be resurrected, the Sharia didn't look at it as though it was even a statement. It looked at it as though it's a claim. It's just a claim. He's claiming it. Ah. It's like somebody claiming another man as his father, saying, this is my father. Because this man's rich, he's my father. He wants to inherit him. It's a claim. The Arabs, they say, الدعاوَ مَا لَمْ تُقِيمَ بِبَيِّنَاتِ الْأَبْنَاءُ وَالدِّعِيَاءُ. Everything that you claim needs evidence, or else everybody will claim what they want. لَوْ يُعْطَى النَّاسَ بِدَعْوَاهُمْ لَدَّعَى رِجَالَ أَمْوَالَ قَوْمٍ وَدِمَاءُمْ. Everybody who claims something will say to them, okay, bring your evidence. Where's your evidence for this claim that you brought? Or else everybody would claim people's bloods and people's money. I would look at somebody who's driving a nice car and say, hey, listen, brother, that's my car. Give me back my keys. It's a claim. So, زَعَمَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَلَّا يُبْعَثُوا. The disbelievers have claimed أَلَّا يُبْعَثُوا, that they're not going to be resurrected. And once the person believes that they're not going to be resurrected, of course, what's going to go? All of actions and righteous deeds are going to go. There's going to go. Because for your actions, you're doing your actions for resurrection in the day of judgment. Now,
وأرسل الله جميع الرسل مبشرين ومنذرين. والدليل قوله تعالى: رسلا مبشرين ومنذرين لئلا يكون للناس على الله حجة بعد الرسل. وأولهم نوح عليه السلام، وآخرهم محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وهو خاتم النبيين لا نبي بعده. والدليل قوله تعالى: ما كان محمد أبا أحد من رجالكم ولكن رسول الله وخاتم النبيين. والدليل على أن أولهم نوح قوله تعالى: إنا أوحينا إليك كما أوحينا إلى نوح والنبيين من بعده. وكل أمة بعث الله إليها رسولا.
The author رحمه الله, he said, when he finished clarifying and explaining that which is connected to our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He clarified our Messenger, things pertaining to him that we needed to know. The author then goes on to speaking about a qa'ida, kulliyatun, a comprehensive principle pertaining to what? Fi ba'thi rusuli, in the sending of messengers. He's going to give you qawa'id, principles of messengers being sent. He says, wa arsala Allahu jami'a ar-rusuli mubashirin wa mundirin. The author mentions that Allah, he sent all of the messengers with two things. The first thing is al-bishara, glad tidings. Messengers, they came to give glad tidings. Glad tidings to what? Ama to who? Liman ata'ahum, anyone who obeys them. What are they going to attain? Bil falahi fi dunya wal akhirah. They are going to attain success, prosperity, harmony in this world and in the hereafter. The second is an-nidara. This also can be said nadara, but the strongest in the language is to make a kasra of the noon. Is to warn. To who lakin? Liman asahum, anyone who disobeys them. What is he going to attain? Al-khusran fi dunya wal akhirah. In this world and in the hereafter, destruction, loss, pain, agony, stress, all of it's going to be for you. Then the author, rahimahullah, he mentioned two extra matters, which is anna awwal ar-rusul, the first messenger is who? Nuh alayhi salatu was salam. The author mentioned that. And the second thing that he mentioned is after this, is anna akhirahum Muhammadun sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the second matter which the Shaykh followed up with the issue is our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the final messenger that was sent. And he said, wa huwa khatamun nabiyyina la nabiyya ba'dahu, that there is no prophet after him. And the evidence that the author brought for Nuh being the first messenger is Allah said in the Quran, inna awhayna ilayka kama awhayna ila Nuhin wa nabiyyina min ba'dih. Allah says to the prophet, inna awhayna ilayka, Muhammad, we sent revelation unto you. Kama awhayna, as we have sent revelation on what? Ila Nuhin, to Nabiullah Nuh. Wa nabiyyina min ba'di, and messengers, and prophets that came after him. So where is the dilala? How is the author trying to take evidence from this? He's taking the evidence from awwaliyyati Nuh. Nuh was the first one mentioned here. And everybody was mentioned after it, because Allah says, inna awhayna ilayka kama awhayna ila Nuhin walladhina min ba'di, and those who came after him. Those who came after him. The second one, which is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final and seal of all prophets. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he brought for this the ayah in the Quran, مَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٍ أَبَى أَحَدٍ مِنْ رِجَالِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَخَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ. Our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is what? خَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ, the seal of all prophets. The author brought that ayah. As for the ayah that he brought for Surah An-Nisa, the ayah that he brought for Nuh being the first messenger, the evidence that he brought for that, it's not very direct, and it can still be argued. What would have been better for the Shaykh to use is a hadith which Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated. Min hadith Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that Adam will say to the people the Day of Judgment when they are asking for the intercession, he will say, "Eatu, go, Nuh, and go to Nabiullah Nuh. أول رسول الله أما أول رسول بعثه الله إلى أهل الأرض." He is the first messenger in which Allah has sent down to the people of the earth. That hadith would have been more direct. But as I said before, Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab's methodology is ayat is sufficient to prove his arguments. When he feels like there is a need for the hadith, he goes for it. The author, he said something very powerful. He said, وَأَوَّلُهُمْ نُوحٌ وَآخِرُهُمْ مُحَمَّدٌ. Here, what is he talking about? وَأَوَّلُهُمْ أَوَّلُهُمْ نُوحٌ. It seems as though he's trying to say Nuh is the first Nabi. He's saying that Nuh is the first messenger. and not the first prophet. صح? Because the beginning, what did he say? وَأَرْسَلَ اللَّهُ. He's talking about أَرْسَلَ الرُّسُل. And then he says, وَأَوَّلُهُمْ, from those messengers. That's what he's trying to say. And that is correct. Because Nuh is the first messenger. As for Adam, Adam is the first Nabi, first prophet. نعم.
وكل أمة بعث الله إليها رسولا من نوح إلى محمد يأمرهم بعبادة الله وحده وينهاهم عن عبادة الطاغوت والدليل قوله تعالى ولقد بعثنا في كل أمة رسولا أن اعبدوا الله واجتنبوا الطاغوت وافترض الله على جميع العباد الكفر بالطاغوت والإيمان بالله. قال ابن القيم رحمه الله تعالى معنى الطاغوت ما تجاوز به العبد حده من معبود أو متبوع أو مطاع. والطواغيت كثيرة ورؤوسهم خمسة: إبليس لعنه الله، ومن عبد وهو راض، ومن دعا الناس إلى عبادة نفسه، ومن ادعى شيئا من علم الغيب، ومن حكم بغير ما أنزل الله. والدليل قوله تعالى لا إكراه في الدين، قد تبين الرشد من الغي، فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى لا انفصام لها، والله سميع عليم. وهذا معنى لا إله إلا الله. وفي الحديث رأس الأمر الإسلام وعموده الصلاة ودرة سنامه الجهاد في سبيل الله، والله أعلم. الحمد لله.
The author رحمه الله, he solidified and he brought the point home, or drove the point home, that the messengers, they've come with what? To give glad tidings and to warn. And he also clarified for us all of the messengers, they were sent to their nations. Sorry, the author now is going to clarify this here. Before, he told us that the messengers and the prophets, the messengers were sent for what? مبشرين ومنذرين, giving glad tidings and warning. Here he's telling us something else, which is every prophet was sent to his nations. Are you with me? The Shaykh says وَأَنَّ كُلَّ أُمَّةٍ بَعَثَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهَا رَسُولًا. Every nation Allah sent a messenger from them. All of the prophets and the messengers, they unite on two things. They all come together on two da'wahs. Their da'wah unites on two things. The first one is al-amru bi'ibadatillah. All of them, they all believe the worshipping of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And i'budullaha is what they all call to. And the second thing which they all united upon is wajtanibu taghuta, and staying away from taghut. And all of this is in the verse of Allah, walaqad ba'athna fi kulli ummatin rasulan an i'budullaha وَجَتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ. Then the author rahimahullah, he explained that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he made it obligatory عَلَى جَمِيعِ الْعِبَادِ, on all of the slaves and all of us, all of the creation, الْكُفْرُ بِالطَّاغُوتِ, to disbelieve in طَاغُوتِ, وَالْإِيمَانُ بِاللَّهِ, and to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال تعالى, Allah said in the Quran, لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الغي فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى لا انفصام لها. So the Shaykh is trying to take it from the ayah. فمن يكفر بالطاغوت, anyone who disbelieves in طاغوت has held on to what? فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى. ما معنى العروة? What does عروة mean? What's the meaning of the word عروة? عروة is ما يتعلق ويستمسك به. Urwa is called, is used for anything you can hold on to. It's a rope. Anything you can hold on to is called the urwa. مَا يُتَعَلَّقُ وَيُسْتَمْسَكُ بِهِ. The word wuthqa is the mu'annath of the word awthaqi. It's the mu'annath of the word awthaqi. And what does awthaq mean? Al-Aqwa, the strongest. That's where it comes, it's the mu'annath of the word. لانفصام لها. What does the word infisam mean? Infisam means لانقطاع لها, no disconnection. it won't break. So a person cannot be one holding onto a rope that won't cut until he comes with two characteristics. What are the two things that he has to come with? حَتَّى يَكْفُرَ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ. You have to disbelieve in طاغوت and believe in who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالطَّاغُوتُ لَهُ مَعْنَيَانِ. طاغوت has two meanings. أَحَدُهُمَا, the first one is مَعْنَى, which is خاص, specific. Generally, we always start with which definition? Well, we're now taking the khas for a reason. Da'a ma'nan khas, specific meaning. And that's shaitan. It's shaitan. If you hear in the Quran that the word ta'ghut is mentioned, عند الاطلاق, unrestrictedly, and there's no external points that are narrowing the meaning down, then فَإِذَا أُطْلِقَ الطَّاغُوتُ. You memorize this qa'id. It's qa'id kulliyah, you can use it. فِي الْقُرْآنِ. If ta'ghut is unrestrictedly used in the Quran, كان هو المراد. Shaitan is the intended one. It's shaitan. The second usage of the word طاغوت is معنى عام, a general meaning. And that is the one the author just brought now from the statement of who? Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. Ibn al-Qayyim's definition of طاغوت is the generic, general meaning. And Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab got this kalam of Ibn al-Qayyim from the kitab إعلام الموقعين. It's from the kitab إعلام الموقعين, which Ibn al-Qayyim says ما تجاوز به العبد حده. It is when a slave exceeds his limits. من معبود, whether it's a معبود, أو متبوع, whether it's one that's worshipped, أو متبوع, or one that's followed, أو مطاع, or one that's obeyed. So he mentioned three. And that is the best definition that has been said, the word ta'ghut in its general meaning. And Abdul Rahman ibn Hassan is the grandson of the Shaykh, in his sharah of Kitab al-Tawheed, Fath al-Majid, and also the student of Abdul Rahman ibn Hassan, whose name is Sulaiman ibn Sihman, am al-Sahman, both ways are said, he also chooses that definition of Ibn al-Qayyim, and they took that on board. And it is what is intended in the ayah that the author just brought right now, and not the generic meaning. The author then mentions that the tawaghit are a lot, but the heads are five. The heads here means أعظمهم شرًا وأشدهم خطرًا. The word ras here means the most dangerous of them, the most severest of them are five. The first one is أولهم إبليس. The first one is إبليس. والثاني, the second one is من عبد وهو راض. Anyone who is worshipped and is pleased with being worshipped. So Nabila Isa is not in here, because Isa is not pleased with being worshipped. So you can't call Isa a ta'ghut. من عبد وهو راض. The one who is worshipped and is pleased to be worshipped. Three. من ادعى شيئا من علم الغيب. The one who claims that he knows the unseen, and he says, I know the unseen, is a طاغوت. Four. من دعى الناس إلى عبادة نفسه. The one who calls the people to worship him. Five. من حكم بغير ما أنزل الله. The one who judges by other than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down is a طاغوت. The one who judges by other than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he sent down is a طاغوت. وهذا آخر البيان على هذا الكتاب النفاع بما يناسب المقام وفق الله الجميع لما يحبه ويرضى والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على عبده ورسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.